Since we played the 4th of July video again, we're now playing the National Anthem.
Intro by the Beatles this week.
It did kind of sound like the National Anthem.
Yeah, I did. Like, what are we doing?
Got the patriotic song starting us off.
Yeah.
I'm just going to let that play in the background. We can't hear it, so if anything is not good that plays.
It's the Beatles. I mean, it's in the 60s. I think we're good.
Well, welcome to the podcast. I'm going to be talking a little weird today. I've still got half numb lip. I went in this morning to the dentist to get checked out with some tooth pain, and they decided to cut out a crown and numb me and reprep it, and so I'm mostly unnumb now.
Did you just say patooth?
I might have. There's a section of my lip that I cannot control still. Yeah. So.
When you came into staff meeting, man, you're kind of jacked up a little bit.
That's because, yeah, I couldn't smile.
No.
It was not good.
No, not at all. Like nothing on
and
one.
And then y'all kept staring
face,
at me, so then I couldn't stop smiling because I'm like, ah! I'm like, rah, 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 rah. So if I say anything a little weird, that is a whine. Mm. But, so we started off with the Beatles this week. We got there a different intro song. Ask Jeff if he had anything.
It wasn't my choice.
But and he did not.
It was Patty's choice.
Patty had something, though.
It was so good.
Yeah. Yeah, this week we were in 1 Corinthians 13, so wanted to start off with
love.
A song about love.
Yeah.
I had a good one picked, but we didn't use it.
It was a little different.
Yeah, but our listeners would have known it.
They would have.
I think.
There's a lot of songs out there about love, though.
And you would have received royalties since you're the fourth member of the Black Eyed Peas.
I'm the fifth Black Eyed Pea that never got the call back. I never got the call back.
Also, if
they're
we...
Like they were going for five. Like I was in. It was in the 90s. I was in. They were like, we decided we're going to go four. I'm like, okay.
Just missed it.
Whatever.
You were robbed.
Yeah, that's right. I think I chose the right career path. Maybe not the Black Eyed Peas.
Probably wouldn't have worked out well. No. If you tried to watch this on YouTube and it got flagged, it's because we...
That is why.
But it's because of Patty's song choice.
That's all right. That's
hopefully okay. We didn't, and you can still watch us right now. But
nice.
Yeah. Anyways, actually, hopefully you can't.
Does it shut the whole thing down or just the song part?
It says different things. It says like... So all the ones that we've had have just said like parts of your video might be muted in certain parts of the world. And then I looked at the parts of the world and it's like Russia. So
kind of like parts of your mouth
are definitely muted right now.
Yeah.
Nice. So if you're trying to watch in Russia,
but we don't want to draw attention to it, to our viewers, those who are actually watching.
I have a feeling it's going to be a common theme to the podcast,
which would be my wife and your mother. So anyway, that's fine. But we're glad you are. We're glad you watch. Does your mom watch?
Oh yeah. I think they more listen, but yeah, my dad definitely does.
Honest. Jeff, we should just mimic Cameron to make him feel better.
Okay.
We can talk like
no!
Cameron.
No, get out of here.
Exactly.
It's getting there. Maybe by the end, there
That's
it is.
That's what true that friends bad. Do.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. They don't make fun of your infirmities.
It's all the, I'm trying to.
Challenges.
Anyways. Okay. Let's talk about
love.
1 Corinthians so you can talk
Let's
and not
talk
me.
About, yeah.
All right. So, yeah, 1 Corinthians 13, one of the most probably well-known love chapters in the Bible.
Probably definitely the most popular chapter in 1 Corinthians.
Yeah.
Like, I bet there's a True. Lot of people who don't know anything about 1 Corinthians, but they've heard that.
Yeah.
You know, at a wedding.
A lot of weddings.
Or something like that.
Absolutely. I was looking up, obviously, love is a huge, you might even say, central theme in the Bible. Those different articles said different things. I know there's different translations and stuff, but... there's over 500 uses of the word love in the Bible, which is a lot. It's one of the top, like 100, it's probably higher than that, but top 100 words used in the Bible. Mm-hmm. And obviously some of those words are a, the, and, so for it to be up there
Articles,
with some of
yeah.
the, yeah, it's pretty, pretty big.
Absolutely.
I can remember growing up and I bet she still does this, but my grandma in her Bible, she always, and she's probably listening now. She knows I'm talking about her. But she always, anytime she sees love, she colors in the O. So in her Bible,
oh, really?
Every single time it says love,
that's
she'll color
cool.
in the O. So
that's really cool.
What do you call her?
Maul.
Shout out to Maul.
Shout out to Maul. She listens every week.
Love to Maul.
Exactly. Well, I mean, the Bible is a love story.
Yeah.
That's what we don't really look at it that way or understand that. But when you look at the scriptures and realize it's one story from Genesis all the way to Revelation.
Yeah.
And it's a love story of God's revelation to his people.
Yeah.
You
absolutely.
Know? And and Jesus is the main actor of that story. And so it's when you look at it that way, it gives it a completely different perspective.
Yeah, it changes a lot. I wrote down a couple verses about love that we all know, but John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, that someone laid down his life for his friends. And then obviously the great commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, love your neighbor as yourself. It's Matthew 22. So with love being such a huge theme in the Bible, why, and I guess you just answered this with saying it's a love story, but why is love such a huge theme throughout the Bible?
Yep. Well, because I think you go back to 1 John, I think it's 1 John 5, it may be earlier than that, but where, you know, John makes a statement, things that we call theological absolutes. God is love. You know, so when we think about love, we think about it's something that we're going to attempt to do. Like it's a verb more for us. Mm-hmm. It's not really a noun. It's not who we are. It's what we do, right? We love others.
Yeah.
John makes a statement about God. He says, God is love. Mm-hmm. So it's a theological absolute. That is his character. It's who he is. He is love. Everybody says, well, the Old Testament doesn't seem like you're demonstrating that very much. You know, because you've got a lot of the wrath, and you've got a lot of, you know, in the Old Testament, you've got God's reaction and response to sin. Mm. And so you see in all the Old Testament of the wars and the murders like this, that is God's response to sin, because God hates sin and his wrath is going to be poured out against sin. Mm-hmm. But even in the very beginning, there was love. You know, you look at the garden, take the garden, for example, when Adam and Eve sinned. Right. I mean, it would have been very easy in that moment in time for God to just say, you know what? Done.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was listening to something yesterday. I don't remember what it was. And I never thought about this. But this guy said that Kierkegaard, I probably not saying that right, but I remember reading him in Philosophy of Religion, which I didn't love. But, you know, he said anxiety existed. Think about this, man. Anxiety existed in Adam before sin. Hmm. So when Adam and Eve were presented with the choice, they were presented with something that they were told they needed was greater than God, could make them like God. The anxiety in Adam and Eve created in them the reality that there was a choice. That's what I'm saying. Like, that's Kierkegaard. Like, that's those philosophy religion guys that you go, wait a minute.
Just thinking about this.
I don't even want to think about stuff like that, you know, because it's just, it's crazy. I'll never forget my philosophy of religion professor was named Yandel Woodfin in seminary. Like, if your name is Yandel Woodfin, that's, you got to be a philosopher, right? That's just a great name.
Yeah.
And he would always go to the board. I probably told you the story. He would draw a circle and he would draw a bunch of dots in the circle. And he said, this represents the infinite sea of being. B-E-I-N-G, and that we all exist in this infinite sea of being, and all we have to define. I'm like, dude, what is wrong with you? Like, what are you talking about? We don't exist in an infinite sea of being. Like, I never forget that. I'm like, I'm going to be tested on this. Like, I got to memorize stuff like this, you know? I remember it, but I don't remember much more about it than that. But anyway, so when you talk about theological absolutes with God, God is love. And so in the garden, Adam and Eve sinned. So when they sinned, what was God's first response to that? Think about that. He responded out of love, not out of anger and wrath. Adam, where are you? So what is the impetus of that question? Did God not know where he was? Like, was God asking for a geographical location?
Yeah.
No, he was giving Adam a chance to tell God what he had done.
Right.
Does that come out of anger and wrath? That comes out of love. I mean, God responded because that's who God is. God is love. And so we see Adam respond the way he did. He blames Eve. Eve blames the serpent. It goes on from that. You know, sin affects the world. And so thus begins this great love story of God redeeming his creation.
Yeah.
That he would model with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden when an animal that, think about this, death was never intended to be a part of the garden. Adam and Eve were given what to eat?
The fruit of the land?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not a trick question.
Yeah. It's
and there's not a king's name involved, so you're good. But they were given the products, the vegetables and fruit, like all of those things is what they were given to eat. It was never intended for them to kill an animal and eat an animal in the garden. And what happened when Adam and Eve sinned? They tried to cover themselves because that's what we do. We try to make up for our sin in some form or fashion. And next thing you know, that God covers them with skins. Mm-hmm. Skins of what? Mm. Of an animal that he had to kill to cover his creation. Mm. So there was a sacrifice that was made in the garden. And God began at that point covering, just like he covered Adam and Eve, he would cover the sins of mankind through the Old Testament until the ultimate sacrifice would come.
Yeah.
And not only cover, but pay for our sin. Mm. So the love story began in the garden.
Yeah.
Right? And we see it all play out up until Jesus comes on the scene. And Jesus comes on the scene and then begins presenting the love. I mean, he was the ultimate, not just example, but I don't know how you talk about this in theater, but like the climax of the play, like the ultimate point of the revelation of God's love came through.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yep.
And then he came on the scene and everybody was like, oh, wait a minute. You're not responding the way we thought you're, you know, well, it's because he's responding in love, you know? And so I think that's why it's so important that we get that, that God is love. I mean, even in the Old Testament, you know, God would say, I desire mercy, not sacrifice.
Yeah.
You know, through the prophet Amos, he would say, I hate, I despise your feasts. I despise your offerings. I despise your services. Mm-hmm. I desire mercy. I don't need you to sacrifice for me. I don't need you to do something out of obligation. Mm-hmm. I want you to do something out of a heart of love.
Yeah.
You know, but they were incapable of doing that because there wasn't a spirit in them that allowed them to love like they needed to love.
Yeah.
And so I think that's the picture of the New Testament in Jesus coming and giving us a heart. You know, Jeremiah, I think it was Jeremiah that prophesied that God would take this heart of stone and put inside of us a heart of flesh, you know, a heart that was able. So what's he mean by that? You know, a heart that was capable of loving, that was capable of feeling, that was capable of responding to others the way Jesus, that way, the way we have been responded to by God.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, like you read some of those verses, there's so many great verses that describe God's love. I mean, John 3:16, which is a verse everybody, you know, at least has some kind of knowledge about. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son.
Yep.
That whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yeah.
For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. You know? So I think it's just who he is.
Yep.
And I think we love to get on the other side of God's anger and God's wrath and preach that, and we think we're being soft if we preach the love of God. The reality is we were talking about this before the podcast started. To me, there's nothing no harder in the scripture than when John says in 1 John, if you say you love God and you hate your brother, you're a liar. Like the love of God is not in you.
Yeah.
The Spirit of God does not exist in you. If you say you love God and yet you respond to your brothers and sisters in a way that doesn't reflect the love of Christ, well, you're a liar. You know, well, what have we said in churches about people like that? Nah, that's just the way they are. Oh, so-and-so, he's grumpy. That's just the way he is. Now, yeah, I mean, can people, you know, be a cup half empty people who kind of lean in the dark side of that personality? Sure. But I can tell you this. If we're constantly and consistently being people who aren't reflecting the love of Christ in our life, you better be asking some questions before you enter the gates.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, John's very clear. Man, if you say you love God and hate your brother, there's something not there that should be there.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, that's good. And I love that perspective of the whole Bible being a love story too, because it really is. You know, I think we've all probably heard the question, what's up with God in the Old Testament versus the New Testament? Why don't we have the wrath of God in the Old Testament, the love of God in the New Testament?
Yeah.
And you look at some of these stats when I was looking it up, there's more, it used the word love more in the New Testament than it does in the Old Testament, which is Old Testament is much larger. But I think a big part of that is, you know, the Old Testament's more, it's more stories. It's about the people of God and kind of that, just you think of the storyline and you said the climax of Jesus coming on the scene, that's when like God made his presence here on this earth.
Yeah.
Love entered all, like that's where it really took off.
Love arrives. I mean, love is here.
Yep. Yeah. And so, and then there's stories pointing back then to Jesus and how we should be living our lives like mm-hmm. him. So it makes sense that it's so compact with love in the New Testament, but it makes it look like that when that's really God loves his people all through the
scriptures.
Yeah.
But in his nature and who he is, he hates sin.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So because of that, he responds to sin in a way that comes out of his character.
Yeah.
But all of that's driven through the love for his creation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, even in the Old Testament, it was reckoned to Abraham as righteousness. Why? Because he believed mm-hmm. God. So there was still that opportunity in the Old Testament,
right?
You know, yep. to believe and to have that righteousness reckoned to you.
Yeah, absolutely. I love the language that you, or the second point, the language you use there, speaking the Father's language, and kind of going through the verses that we all know. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It's not puffed up. Love sees value. It doesn't have a scoreboard. It does not seek evil. And love puts us under the roof of God's protection and keeps us there. We did have a question submitted this week kind of regarding one of those, so we'll go ahead and hit that. They said 2 Corinthians 5:10, and also in Romans 14:10, it mentions standing before God at judgment, and we mm-hmm. talked about this some when we were going through Revelation as well. So with this, how does this correlate with 1 Corinthians 13:4, which is your point up here, love doesn't have a scoreboard.
Yeah.
Scorecard.
Yeah. I may have put board in mine. I don't know. Anyway. But yeah, well, I think it's a great question. And I love that people are thinking about scripture. They're trying to connect the dots with scripture. You know, I think that's awesome. So when it talks about in that passage, it says love keeps no record of wrongs. It's really, really important that we understand that. So when we talk about love keeping no records, love does keep records. It keeps records of the right things that we do, not the wrong things that we do. Mm-hmm. You know, when we stand, when 2 Corinthians 5, when it talks about us standing before the judgment seat of Christ, we will, as believers in Christ, stand before the judgment seat of Christ to be rewarded for the good things that we've done here in the body, right, on the earth. Mm-hmm. And so the things that we've done that were not for Christ and were for us, those will be burned away. Mm-hmm. What will be left will be those things that we've done for Christ that will last for eternity.
Yeah.
And so it's those things that we will be rewarded for. So it's again, and we've talked about this, but to refresh ourselves, to answer the question, the judgment seat of Christ is what they call the Bema seat. The Bema seat was actually in Corinth, and where they had the Isthmus Games, Isthmus, that's why it's hard to say. Could you say Isthmus?
Nope.
Yeah, I didn't think so with your mouth. So, it was those games, and then when the competitors, when they won their medals, and they didn't win a medal, they won a crown of, I don't know what it was. It was a crown of whatever.
Twirly-twirlies.
Yeah, twirly-twirlies that you kind of see on shows and movies. When they were awarded that, they would go up to the Bema seat, and they would be awarded their crown. And so Paul is using that picture. I just love when you know cultural content.
Yeah.
I mean, context, how Paul, like the Corinthians are seeing this. Like, so it would be like us getting ready to watch the Olympics. You guys excited about the Olympics coming up?
Yeah.
End of July, they start. Real excited about that. Going to watch wrestling and some of the things.
Of course.
But yeah, but to think about like seeing those people come up to that, they're given a gold, silver, bronze medal. And so, you know, I think that's the picture that Paul's painting in that judgment seat of Christ. Those people aren't judged for what they did wrong. They're rewarded for what they did right.
Yeah.
And that will be what we as believers go through. Now, I think the negative aspect of that for us as believers is to think, okay, I may get up there and, you know, once the bad stuff's kind of burned away, what I spent my life doing as a believer in Christ that was for me, there may not be much left.
Yeah.
Well, the reality is we need to live our lives on purpose for Christ here while we're here. So yeah, there's an urgency for that for us. But in no way will at the Bema seat, the judgment seat of Christ, will anything that we've done that would be considered sin be talked about or dealt with. Mm-hmm. That was dealt with on the cross.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, our judgment as believers has nothing to do with anything we've done wrong.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, some could say, well, that doesn't make a lot of sense to me because those things that will be burned up aren't those things we've done wrong. Mm. Right. So great question. I think basically that's just kind of burning away the things that we did not do for Christ. So it's not punishment in that, but we do need to understand that, you know, from the time I became a believer until the time I meet Jesus, there's a period of time there that I've been given. It's a gift. So what did I do with that gift? And you can't, here's the thing you got to remember. You can't buy back time. Mm. We were talking I don't remember who I was talking to. It was over the weekend. We were at Julie's mom and dad's and I was talking to her nephew and he's just leaving the Air Force, getting ready to become a pilot. And his goal is to have he's going to use what he learned in the Air Force to have eventually he wants to have a ministry where he transports organs for organ donors. And then he eventually wants to do some mission work with that dude. Great, great young guy, Josh Archer, just a super, very smart guy. And so he wants to eventually do that. So anyway, we were talking about pilots and becoming a pilot and how he could, if he wanted to, be a commercial pilot and fly for an airline. You know, he's qualified to do that. And he was telling me like how much money those guys make, which is crazy. Yeah. I'm like, I didn't realize how much money, like an airline pilot for a Delta or something like that. And he said this as a young man, and Josh is a pretty wise fella. He said, you know, he said, I could do that and I could make a ton of money. He said, but I would be away from my home 3 or 4 or 5 nights in a row. And he said, that's just that life, which something I've always said to my kids and anybody else that I try to help disciple is, you can make a lot of money in life, but there's always a cost. Mm. Like there's just always a cost. I mean, any one of us could choose to go work a different career, you know, make a lot more money, but there's a cost to that. You don't make money, a lot of money, and spend a lot of time with your family. Like you just don't get both, you know, unless you just inherit a ton of money and you know, whatever. But most people, if you're going to work, yes, you could make that kind of money. He said, but I mean, his wife's pregnant with twins. Mm. They have a 2 or 3 year old and he's like, yeah, I'm not going to be away from my family that much. So, you know, there's always a trade-off, right? Yeah. And so we get a certain amount of time and I looked at Josh and I said, Josh, let me tell you something that you're figuring out. You get one shot at this. Like you've got a 3 year old and we prayed for Will. Remember Will was going through where he had to come down to Vanderbilt and had those issues. And we were praying for him and his family. And Josh understands the value of that because he's been away some with military. He's been deployed. Mm-hmm. One of his buddies just got deployed. He's like, man, if I would have stayed in, Jeff, he said, I would have gotten deployed who knows how many more times. Yeah. And he knew that. And so anyway, all that to say, we have a certain amount of time and we need to use that time wisely. You know, how we invest that time, we're going to be kind of judged for our investment there. So to answer the question, that's the judgment seat of Christ for us. It's the awards. You know, watch the Olympics and know we're going to go through that award ceremony with Jesus, which is going to be awesome. And I think that's a great picture of love, though, because our flesh definitely keeps a record of wrongs. Mm-hmm. You know, you can go through that list and replace the word love with flesh and reverse what it says. Mm-hmm. It's a really interesting way to read that list. Mm. Your flesh is not patient. Your flesh is not kind. Mm. And then take the negatives and make them positives. The next 8. Love envies. Love boasts. I mean, flesh. Flesh envies. Flesh boasts. Flesh is prideful. Your flesh keeps a record of wrongs. Like reverse the list, put flesh in there for love and ask yourself the question, which one looks more like me? Mm. Dude, that's a great exercise.
Yeah.
I wish I would have said that yesterday when I was preaching. Because that really, when you think about that, like if we would just take that as an exercise, okay, all you listeners out there, all 10 of you, if you would take, this would be a great, like this is a great discipleship exercise.
Yeah.
Take that list and do that. Put flesh in love and then reverse it. Make it to where it's 2 positive and 8 negatives. Make it 2 negatives and 8 positives and replace flesh in there. And look at both lists and go, which one looks like me the most? Mm. That'll really help you see man, I do need to be more like this instead of this.
Yeah, that's good.
You know, and man, that's a great exercise, man. I need to go do that after the podcast. I know, right? Yeah, that's I get these great ideas a day later. How's that happen?
It's a bit too late.
Yeah. So anyway, but it's just that important, man. You know, yeah. That's where it really came back to for me, that the title of this message, it came out of that N.T. Wright quote.
Yeah.
That I just when I was reading and doing some research, N.T. Do you have that quote pulled up?
I do. Read that. Yeah, he said, N.T. Wright said that love is the language that is spoken in the next life, and that love is not only our duty but our destiny.
Yeah, and I began to think, wow, man, you know, there really is a language in eternity, like a language that is spoken in eternity, and it's the Father's language because it's who He is, mm-hmm. and His language is love, yeah. and for us to see that any differently means we don't understand the Father. Mm-hmm. Like if we don't get that and we don't understand that, you don't get the Father. You don't understand the Father.
Yeah,
it is the language of eternity. Yeah. And then when you think about that concept and start reading 1 Corinthians 13, you really see that in all that Paul's saying. You know, when he gets down into that parts of the passage where he says, these things will cease, but this is going to continue. These things will go away, but this is going to continue.
Right.
You know, I think it's very, very interesting knowing the context that he's speaking to the Corinthians about what remains, and what remains is love.
Yeah, absolutely. To the flip side of, you talked about the Bema seed and that, now I'm stuck on Great White Throne Judgment, the judgment seat of Christ. Judgment
seat of Christ, yeah.
So to the flip side with the Great White Throne Judgment, some may ask, you know, if love doesn't keep a record of wrong and God loves the world that He gave His only Son, how can we say that God loves us if He's keeping a record of wrongs? And then like with the Great White Throne Judgment and sending people to hell, mm-hmm. how would you respond to that side?
Yep, that's a good question. So the Great White Throne Judgment is the judgment reserved for those people who have rejected Jesus Christ as payment for their sin.
Yeah.
And so we'll all stand before God. I think there's, you know, maybe some confusion in that, but the reality is that we all have to face God. Mm-hmm. We all have to face the judge. Mm-hmm. Our sin has to be dealt with. And so either we are going to stand before God and basically try to justify our sin, or we're going to stand before God and Jesus will stand as our advocate. Mm-hmm. And our sin will be justified through Jesus. And so this group of people who have rejected Christ as payment for their sin, all of those people are going to this place what we call hell right now, which is really a waiting place. It's a holding place until the Great White Throne Judgment. And so until all of those that would ever reject Jesus, until all of that historically is taken care of, and that's why the Great White Throne Judgment is one of the last things that happens mm-hmm. before the new heaven and the new earth come. Mm. So you got to wait until like all people have had an opportunity.
Yeah.
You know, even through, you got to think about like even in the millennial reign, right? There'll be people still who reject Christ, mm-hmm. which is kind of crazy to think about, but because Satan will be let loose one more time. And so until all that's done, those people will stand before God and they will give an account for their righteousness. And either we are going to be found righteous in Christ or we're going to be found righteous in ourselves. And we will not be found righteous in ourselves.
Yeah.
You know, we're walking through the book of Romans, at least the first six chapters on Wednesday night right now. And Paul spends the first three chapters talking about our guilt. And then chapter four, he talks about, you know, how no one will be able to stand before God without Jesus. Because we will all stand guilty. I mean, all are guilty. That's why, and that's that great verse in Romans 3, for all fall short of the glory of God. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Like we will not and we cannot meet His glory. Yeah. So when we choose to reject the path of love that Christ has given us, then yes, there is a record of our wrongs. There's definitely a record of our wrongs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to say, how does that work with God whose language is love? Well, the language of love provided a way for us not to be in that judgment. The language of love, and that's why it says love does not keep a record of wrongs. The path of love does not keep a record of wrongs because our wrongs have been placed on Jesus. But when we choose to reject that, then we're on our own at that point.
Yeah.
And so when we've said, listen, we've got a better way, we've got a better path, then we've got to deal with our choices. We've got to deal with the result and what comes out of our choices. Yeah. And that will be standing before a holy God and answering for our sin.
Yeah, absolutely. So with this idea of love, like we see the greatest example of love, obviously, in Jesus, that the God that created everything mm-hmm. sent his son to come and redeem, to be a hope for all of creation, to die for the sins that we are committing in 2024. And so if he is our greatest example, if we're called to live a life like his, to love like he loved, and that's really the gist of Christianity. Like we talked about, that's the main theme of the Bible. Like mm-hmm. that's what the Bible is. Why do we sometimes as Christians struggle with that so much, showing love? And I know, you know, we've talked about kind of the pendulum swing. So those, you know, by the way, my lip's feeling pretty good. I'm talking pretty good now, by the way.
Kinda.
Better. but you've got, I think, kind of a pendulum swing in culture that yeah. goes from and away from love, along with a lot of other things. But I think it's the same in the Christian world, too, and in the church world. Like, oh, we got to love everybody. And, oh, it's all about, you know, hellfire, brimstone side. Right. So we kind of swing that way at times, too. But why do we sometimes have a hard time loving those who maybe don't look like us or are different or have a different set of opinions? Why is that a struggle for us when that's like the main thing that we're supposed to be doing?
Yeah, Patty, jump in anytime you want to.
I naturally look at Jeff because if I'm looking at both of y'all, I have to like swivel around.
You look
the
to
mic.
Me and I'm looking at yeah. Patty, you know, so I'm like,
I'll just look straight ahead next
year. Yeah, yeah. Well, I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but I don't want to exclude you over there either.
Thanks, Jeff.
You're welcome. It's out of love, my love for you. I don't want to exclude you. Well, I think Paul goes into that in the latter parts of chapter 13 because he says, you know, basically we love in part. We love in partial right now, but there will be a time when the partial's gone.
Yep.
We've been given in us the ability to love unconditionally, mm-hmm. but we also in that have to wrestle with the flesh that is very selfish.
Yeah.
So I think that's why Paul's talking about, man, now we know in part, but then we will know fully as we are fully known.
Yeah.
So while we have the ability in us to love that way, to respond that way, we have in us the ability to overcome our flesh and not let our flesh be the one that wins, we still find ourselves kind of succumbing to that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, right now we love with a challenge. There'll be a time when we love without a challenge. And so that's why we have to be a lot more aggressive is probably not the right word, but intentional, I guess, is the better word, about learning how to speak the language of the Father. Like, we've got to learn and realize that it's how we respond in love that we're overcoming our flesh and responding out of our spirit.
Yeah.
You know, so it really does, it comes back down to the battle of the spirit and the flesh
yeah.
that Paul talks about is so difficult and so prevalent in our lives every single day. Man, it's in us. We've yeah. got it. If you know Jesus Christ, you've been given the spirit to know how to love. But we also know, Paul says, and it's like seeing through a glass dimly.
Right.
You know, like our ability to love unconditionally. Because here's the reality, guys. All of us, all three of us, in our lives, in our relationships with our spouses, at some point find ourselves loving conditionally. We just do. I mean, this is our flesh. Like, our flesh says, man, if I do this, maybe then this, or I do, you know. So when you start bargaining with love, yep. that's a conditional love. Like, yep. unconditional love is us loving with expecting nothing in return, mm-hmm. you know? And so it's just, we find ourselves doing that. Our kids grow up doing that. The world teaches them that.
Do you think right? we have, like, as humans, do you think we have the capacity to love unconditionally?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because if Christ lives in us, we have the capacity to love unconditionally. Mm. But I think the partial part of that is that you still have a flesh that you have to wrestle with, mm-hmm. right? Because I think it's a really good question, Cameron, because I think people hear, you know, the agape love, the unconditional love, and you think, well, man, I should be doing that all the time and I don't. Well, we don't, because we still have this partial
yeah.
life that we're living. Like there's going to be a time when we don't struggle to love unconditionally.
Right.
Right now we struggle to love unconditionally, you know, because we still get angry. There's still people that just grate us and they're hard to love.
Yeah.
You know, and there won't be that when we get to eternity, when this partial is removed.
Yeah.
There won't be that for us.
Yeah.
So yes, I do think we have the, because I think that's why John can say in 1 John, if you say you love God and hate your brother, you're a liar.
Right.
You know, so, but we, our flesh says, love those who are easy to love, love those who are most like you, and love those who, but that's not really unconditional love.
Yeah.
I mean, it's easy to love certain, you know, we've got the list, but I think what Jesus wants us to, like, I think when we are, like, I think about the God that led me to Christ, and the way that he loved me was that, like, this guy just, he just chose to be my friend.
Yeah.
And I didn't like this guy. Like, it wasn't like, I was like, man, I hope that guy likes me. Yeah. You know, I hope he's my friend. You know, I just looked at him and I was like, who is he? You know, like, why is this little weirdo, you know, wanting to be on our wrestling team? And he was just so different, man. I wish you ever wish you had a video camera and I could have videoed that and just, you know, because it's such a real story to me. And I know it's, but just thinking about it and the way that I won't say made fun of him, but just didn't include him, you know, but he never gave up.
Yeah.
Like, it was just the weirdest thing. And the things that he would do for me, and it just didn't make sense.
But you wonder how many times he thought about it, just walking away.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, that battle with the flesh.
Yeah.
Of, I'm not getting anywhere, why try?
Yeah. He actually told me after I got saved, he said, man, you don't know how many times I wanted to give up.
Yeah.
You know, I just wanted to give up because I just didn't see it happening. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just didn't see it coming together, you know. But in all of that time, like, he never... And maybe he just knew I wouldn't respond to this, but he never condemned me. Mm-hmm. He never, like, ever told me the things that I was doing that was wrong. And now he had boundaries and he wouldn't cross them and all that. But he never, man, he just loved me, man. I don't know any other way to say it, mm-hmm. you know. And he didn't need anything from me, didn't want anything from me, you know. The way that he responded to losing in a wrestling match and things like that I didn't understand, mm-hmm. because all of my value and all of my worth was in that. And I'm like, this guy has to be that. I never forget being at Clemson that one time and him just getting destroyed by a kid named Hoffman and him coming to me and just going, all right, man, I'm like, how can you do this, man? Yeah. How can you be concerned about me when you just got smashed, you know? But anyway, it was way he loved me, right? That's what turned me to Christ. And that's what helped me understand, man, because I just remember saying, like, I want what you got. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to be able to respond to people the way you respond to people.
Yeah.
You know? And he said, man, it's just Jesus and me knowing Jesus. It's not me.
And Paul knew that. There's a reason he ordered chapter 13 and begins with the supremacy of love.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because everything else is pretty much nil.
Yes.
Without having love. We can do the best of things with what we consider the best of intentions, but if we're not motivated by love, it's irrelevant.
Yeah.
Well, and that's why he says what he says at the beginning of chapter 13. It's because of the context of where 13's found. 11 and 12, he starts getting into issues they were having in their worship mm-hmm. services, right? The Corinthian church was a very gifted church. Mm-hmm. A lot of people were flaunting their gifts. They were misusing their gifts. They were using their gifts for their personal gain and not for the glory mm-hmm. of Christ and the edification of the church. And so they're you know, they had great orators, they had great speakers, they had people who were exercising their faith, all of these things, and it was causing a problem. So Paul had to use 11 to talk about order, and he had to use 12 to talk about spiritual gifts and their purpose and edification of the body and not the individual. And then 14, he's going to kind of wrap that up. Well, right in the middle is the love chapter.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he lets them know, listen, you can get up there and speak as great as you want to speak, but if you don't do it with love, you're just a clanging cymbal. Mm-hmm. It's hollow. And I love that Greek phrase. It doesn't echo the love of the Father, mm-hmm. you know? And that's what he's saying. He's saying echo love. Mm-hmm. It doesn't echo love. Like if our, you know, if you know how many preachers I've heard, maybe you guys as well, you know, they create these great messages and they've got everything planned out and you can, like, they're angry and they're yelling and all of this. And you just, like, it's not coming out of a heart of love. Like, if we discipline our children and we don't do it out of love, we're doing it out of anger and it's not beneficial for them.
Yeah.
You know, when in a Paul saying this, when you're preaching, and yes, does love sometimes drive us to have to discipline and speak difficult and speak hard? Yeah, it does. It sure it does. But it comes out of a heart of love. It should break your heart to have to do that. But we have to do it because we love. You know, was it Penn and Teller? I think Penn, whichever the one that talks, and there's one that talks and one that doesn't talk, you know, in their act. And he said, he's not a believer, but he said, how could a person that believes what the Bible says say they love someone and not tell them that they're going to go to hell without Jesus? Mm. How could you say that you love me and not tell me that?
Wow.
So yeah, it's hard. Sometimes, you know, love has to be hard. So I don't, it's not all the mushy that we want to kind of create it to be, man. It is the language of the Father. And so I can speak like an angel, but if I don't have love, clanging cymbal, you know, I can have faith that moves mountains. And if I don't have love, I'm nothing.
Yeah.
Paul said, you know, and then he goes on and he says, if I could give away everything I've got, and if I'm not doing it out of a heart of love, I gain nothing. And basically Paul's saying, man, if we don't, he's telling the Corinthian church, if you don't do what you do in your services because you love people and want to see people come to Christ, then it's worthless. You know, it's just another, it's just another event.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we have to remember, man. You know, without love, which is, again, the language of the Father, we're wasting our time.
Yeah. Yeah. So back, kind of going off your the story of your salvation, your friend too, like how do we as believers, when we are going and sharing the gospel, we're loving people that are in our lives, how do we do that maybe have different lifestyles? And maybe you could share your experience with him or other, and what scripture speaks to as well. But how do we love them well in the midst of that without being accepting of their sin or their lifestyle? Or, and some are in the world we live in are a little bit more permanent lifestyles at times. So how do we love someone well like Jesus would if he were in this 2024 world that we're living in?
Yeah.
Without being accepting of that to the point that you know, we are, there may be another word other than accepting, but just condoning, I guess, maybe their sin as opposed to speaking to it.
Yeah, man, I think that's a great question. I think that's the challenge that people have anytime we as believers enter into relationships with people that, man, that don't know Christ, that have a lifestyle that reflects someone who doesn't know Christ,
right,
however it manifests itself. And, you know, in my life back then, it was just manifesting itself in, you know, general behavior that someone who doesn't know Christ, who's looking for their satisfaction in a lot of other areas. So it was either, you know, wrestling was my outlet, or whatever you did on the weekends and things of that nature. So you know, that was pretty general. But you take someone who today, like I think about, like in my life, there was never, ever, ever a question, like in my experience, that the guy that led me to Christ approved of my lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Because he didn't live that way.
Yeah.
He didn't need that. And it was the way he responded. So here's the difference, Cameron, and this is it. The way he responded to me showed me he was different. Mm. So like I never question, man, that dude's like one of us. He's just one of us. He just doesn't drink, or he's like one of us. He just doesn't go out and party or whatever. No, he was different in the way he responded to us. Mm. He didn't need to not do what we did for me to know he was different.
Yeah.
I knew he was different by what he did, how he responded to us. That's what made him different to me.
Yeah.
Because I knew he didn't belong with us. Like I knew he didn't belong in our group. I knew that he really shouldn't be my friend because there was no reason for him to be my friend. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So as I think about that, I always think about Rosaria Butterfield,
Butterfield.
You know, I always think about her story. You know, the gospel comes with a house key, and you know, her having an alternative lifestyle and living as a professor, living next door to another professor who was a believer in Christ, and he and his wife just loving her, having her over into their home. Mm-hmm. You know, basically they exposed her to a believer's lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And she was drawn and attracted to how they responded to her. Like they saw, think about that. She saw the love of Christ and how they responded to her. Mm. Not if they condemned her,
right?
How they responded to her in love, right? We think we have to condemn the world. We think we're so afraid somebody's going to think I approve of someone's a lifestyle because I'm not condemning their lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You know, man, thank the Lord that Steve never worried about how other Christians thought about him hanging out with me.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't care. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad he didn't care. I mean, could have other believers on the campus at Carson Newman have thought, man, I wonder why Wright just doesn't worry about hanging out with those people.
Yeah.
You know, now they could have said, well, he's a wrestler, so he's got to hang out with other wrestlers. But there were other wrestlers who didn't, you know, weren't like us. But he hung out. He didn't care.
Yeah.
But for us, like for me especially, and it wasn't just me because I was saved, but that began a snowball effect mm-hmm. of 7 or 8 other guys getting saved. So it wasn't just me that was seeing this. But I think, you know, his strategy was, man, go after the top guy, go after the worst, the hardest, whatever, and then watch the dominoes fall. He was right. You know, and so I think we've got to understand it is all in how we respond. And we got to remember this. John 3:16, great verse. Don't forget John 3:17. Mm-hmm. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world,
that's right,
but to save the world. Yep. The world is already condemned and they know it. Mm-hmm. Like that's the one thing we don't understand.
Yep.
Like there was never a time in my life before I became a Christian that I did not know I was doing wrong. I knew what I was doing was my choice. It was a lifestyle that I was choosing to live, but it wasn't right. Like I knew that. Like nobody had to tell me that.
Yeah.
I knew that. I needed somebody to tell me what was right. Point me to what is right. Show me what is right. You know, and that's what he did. And so I think we've got to be comfortable with having relationships with people who don't know Christ.
Yeah.
And putting boundaries in place.
And that absolutely, like when I challenged him, man, come on, go with us, do this, be this. It's like, nope. He said, you know, like when I, here's, and that's a great point, Patty, because when I invited him to my world, he quickly, mm-hmm. like the only time I think he kind of snapped into kind of place, I would say, is when I invited him to my world. Mm-hmm. And he said, never do it. He said, I'll never cross the line, but I'll always be here for you. You know, I've never forgotten that. Yeah. And so I knew, like, and I would push him. Like, I would say, come on, man, you can do this. You know, like, I would tempt him, so to speak. He's like, not doing it. Mm-hmm. All it would have taken was one time.
Yeah.
And I think I would have got my, I got you, man. Mm-hmm. And, you know, thank the Lord that he had the strength to stand, you know, in Christ at that point. So I think for us, mm-hmm. that's where we've got to be very, very careful, which goes back to 1 Corinthians 10 mm-hmm. that we just got to talking about, right? If we're not conscious of those environments, man, we cross lines and we lose our testimony. Mm-hmm. We lose our effectiveness. And so all of this so works together when you read these scriptures. But no, I think we've got to be showing, you know, I think the love that Christ gives us and puts on our heart is not just for other believers. Mm-hmm. It's our love for the unbeliever and our willingness to befriend and to show people the love of Christ. Like those, man, I'm telling you, what brings people to Jesus is when they see someone love them and they know they don't deserve it.
Yeah. And it's hard work.
It is hard work. It's not easy.
No.
And you know what? I can imagine how many times, you know, Steve was disappointed in me, like depressed, wanted to give up. Just mm-hmm. like, man, is this ever going to happen? You know, what, like, is this ever going to come to fruition? Mm-hmm. But, you know, and we would even have those conversations, you know, later afterwards.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like it was some great big, you know, moment at some event, man. I was laying in a, you know, I was overspending the night at his dorm room in these little twin beds at Alumni Hall, which is called something else now. But it's still there. And I would love to go to that one room and look at that one little bed. And I'm just laying there one night. It was January 5th, 1985, thinking, man, what would happen if I gave my life to Christ? Hmm. Like, I remember looking at him and he was laying in his little bed and I was laying in mine. I was like, man, and it wasn't like we were having a conversation, you know, like it wasn't like he said, hey man, let me give you the Roman road. Hey, let me ask you a question. Yeah. Like he never pressed me like that, you know? But I just remember laying in that bed, and I just remember thinking, I wonder, and this is literally, like, I literally asked him this question. I said, what would it be like if I just gave my life to Jesus? Mm-hmm. And I remember him saying, yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. I mean, and I just wondered, man, was he weary? Was he worn down? You know,
yeah.
I just gotten off of Christmas break and all this, and we just got back from a tournament that I didn't do well in, and I kind of got angry about that. But that's all. He just like, yeah, man, I don't know. Mm-hmm. And so I just lay there, and I was like, man, I don't think I'm going to do it. And I just prayed a prayer. I just, Lord, I don't really know what to say. Like, I was just to myself. He didn't lead me in a prayer or anything, you know? He didn't know till the next morning. And I just said, Lord, whatever he has, it's what I want. Mm. So if I'll give you my life, I'll give you everything, I'll give you all I am, but I want to have a heart like he has. Mm-hmm. I want to love people like he's loved me, you know? And I just said, amen. And I just went to sleep. Like, it wasn't some big, like, oh, you know, see lights. I didn't see anything. I didn't, you know, I just went to sleep. But I'm telling you, I woke up the next morning.
You wasn't a pastor on the stage. You raised your hand.
I was just laying there, you know? And the guy that's been working with me, he didn't get me excited. I mean, he didn't like pray with me or anything, you know? But man, the next morning I woke up and I remember telling him, I said, dude, I got saved last night.
Bet he was excited then.
He was like, what? I was like, man, I prayed, you know, when we went to sleep. I said, I just prayed right before I went to sleep and gave my life to Christ. Mm-hmm. I knew it. So I'm telling you, dude, like, I got saved. And he was like, oh, you know, so it just kind of went from there.
So cool.
I love that story.
But it was all because one guy, like one guy, man, made a decision to love me like that.
Yeah.
And he was persistent.
Yeah.
And sometimes those things, you know, salvation experiences come rapidly within those efforts. But sometimes you don't see it.
Sometimes you're not the fruit bearer.
Man, and that's so hard.
It's true.
I think of this student I had many years ago who stepped into creative arts and, you know, never really became a member of the church or anything, but just really struggled with some identity issues. And the person knew that I knew the struggle, and we had conversations. And there were many times there were things shown or spoken to me that were meant to be shock value or to be persuasive in some way. And it was just so hard not to be offended.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I stand for.
Right.
And here you're bringing this.
Right.
So there was so many levels of frustration, but you know, it was about a 3-year process of walking through those kinds of things and saying, put that away. This is our time to sing.
Yeah.
We sing praises to Jesus.
Yep.
In this room.
Yep.
Jesus receives the highest glory, the highest honor. His name will be praised. And so it was over and over. And I've seen this person on campus at local university. And to this day, the person will come up and hug me and say, I love you, Miss Patty.
Yep.
And they know I love them too, right? It's going to always be a reciprocal love, and it's understood. But I know that lifestyle is still prominent in this person's life, but yet they never fail to reach out in their deepest, darkest hour.
Yeah.
Because they know I'm all in.
That's right.
Right?
You're all in with your love for them.
My love for him.
But your commitment to what you stand for.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And,
yeah.
And I think that's what draws people back to us.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think we've got this feeling that if we become a loving church, then we're just going to let anything and everything into our church, and what are we going to become at that point? You know, and what we don't understand is love always points people to truth. Mm-hmm. Man, it's not loving. I mean, open rebuke is better than silent love. It is not loving to not look at someone and tell them the truth.
Yeah.
To show them the truth. That's not loving.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not condemning someone. That's helping them understand truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so we need to understand that man, like, love, I think, brings somebody in the door. Mm-hmm. And once they get in the door, it's Jesus that transforms their life.
Yeah.
And that's what you're looking for. And it's in relationships. And sometimes it doesn't happen immediately. Sometimes it you know, I remember in student ministry, everybody being so afraid that, man, if you just start reaching all these kids that don't know Jesus and whatever, then, man, you're going to have all this trouble and all this problem. And no, you're not. If you're showing them the love of Christ and pointing them in the right direction, listen, they're coming to your world. You know, there are always boundaries. Mm-hmm. Man, don't be afraid to offend somebody who doesn't know Jesus. Like, they're coming to you because they're looking for something different. You got to realize that.
Yep.
Now, are there some who come just for the free meal? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Have a pizza party. You're going to bring tons of people in. Yeah. That's fine. But when you get them there, man, show them the love of Christ. Mm-hmm. Talk to them about how much Christ loves them and what he did for them and how he died for them. Do you know how many people would love for somebody to say, man, do you know how much you're loved by God? Mm-hmm. They know God exists. He's shown that through creation. He's shown that through the conscience he's put in us. Like, they know it. They know something out there is greater than themselves.
Yeah.
And they would love to know that, because you know what? Not every teenager has a mom or dad that is expressing love.
Mm. Yeah. And so we have to be ready when we say that, you know how much God loves you. We have to be ready for that response of, well, if he did, why?
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah, that's right.
And so we have to be ready.
That's
we
right.
We have to be prepared.
Absolutely. It's such a tension. It's so hard because we want to be so right that sometimes we're afraid to let love do its work.
Yeah. Yep.
But we've got to trust that love will do its work. Mm-hmm. And it will.
Yeah.
I mean, Jesus has proved that.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sitting here thinking when you were talking about truth, I've thought of multiple questions as you've been talking. I'm always thinking about where to go from your conversation. I've thought about multiple, and every one kind of answers itself. One of the things I was going to say is, if love keeps no record of wrong, then do we just love people? Have we been sharing the gospel wrong the whole time? But love not keeping a record of wrong or not keeping a scorecard doesn't negate the fact that love also shares truth.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a difference in not keeping a record of wrong and sharing truth with someone about their standing with Jesus.
Yes.
And so there's that gospel side that, like, sharing truth with them about what scripture says and what their eternity is very different than not keeping a record of their wrongs against us. Another one I was thinking of, I was sitting here trying to just think of some practical handles, like, give us an example of, you know, if someone says this, how do we handle this? But I loved in your testimony that you're laying in the bed and you're like, hey, what, like, so if I give my life to Christ, like, what happens? He's like, I don't know. Like, he's loved you this whole time and he didn't have an answer, and that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, it is okay.
Yeah.
And it's not like you have this perfect picture. Like, I think there's a lot, probably myself included, there's a lot of people that would be tempted to, all right, so, like, he's been working at this for a long time at this point, right?
Yeah.
What's going to change? What's going to be different? Like, it's easy to perk up at that point, but that, oh, like, now's my chance. Yeah. I got to sell it. So, oh, well, this is going to be better. You're going to have this and this and this and this. But no, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Let God do his work, and he is the one who ultimately controls that. And that's how it should be, really. Mm-hmm. And it's not that we shouldn't have an answer. Like, we don't love somebody and just, I don't know anything else other than love.
Mm-hmm. And I think for him, like, he had done so much and he had done enough. And, you know, and I say things like, I'm sitting here thinking about this. I say things like, man, he never preached to me. He never did this. He probably did at some point in time.
Yeah.
You know, like I know he probably did, but that's not what I remember.
Right.
What I remember is how he responded to me in situations where he shouldn't have responded that way in a positive way. You know, it's like, I think about the first guy I led to Christ was another guy on our wrestling team that had come down from New York to wrestle with us. And I mean, like, once I got saved, and then my running buddy Troy got saved, like, a week after I did, a week and a half after I did, we were on this guy. We were like, dude, you got it. Like, you got to do this. You got to do this.
Yeah.
And we were, like, pounding this guy. And he was from New York and did just come to the team in January. And I'll never forget, it was in March during spring break. He came down to my room and said, I'm ready. Mm. I was like, you're ready for what? He said, I'm ready to do what you've been talking to me about. Mm. I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, I'm ready to get saved. I'm like, oh my goodness. Like, dude, what do I do? Like, I don't know. Like, what do I read? You know?
Yeah.
So just, we read something out of the Bible and we said a prayer, but it wasn't any of that saved that guy.
Yeah.
It was when that guy in his heart, before he even got to my room, decided that, man, he wants to be a follower of Jesus. You know, like, that's what saves the guy.
Yeah.
You talk about our answer and our responses. Don't worry about messing it up.
Exactly.
Like, have you ever wondered, man, I had a chance to pray with this guy, but I don't think I said the right words. So you think he saved?
Yeah.
Like, your words, like, our prayers have anything to do with it.
Yeah.
Man, it's when that heart turns to Christ and says, I have no other person to follow but you. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what saves somebody and changes somebody. It's a work of the Spirit, man. Yeah. It's not a work of any of us.
Yeah.
And but again, that's love, yeah. You know. So
and for you, like you said, he probably shared that truth, shared those the gospel with you,
absolutely.
But you remember the love,
that's
and
right.
And it's the love, the way that he responded to you, and the love that he gave you that probably solidified that in your heart. And
100%.
So, like, there's I think way too often we maybe want to do the gospel side, but we forget the love side.
Yeah.
And it's just swept with the wind. Like this, like the first part of this chapter is talking about, right?
Yeah.
Like if we God's truth doesn't return void. So maybe this isn't a right statement, but like if we're just pounding the gospel at people and not loving them,
you're a clanging cymbal.
Cymbal.
I mean, that's what Paul says. Yeah. Because I think the word of God not returning void is when we're speaking and living the word of God.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if it was Augustine and one of the early church fathers that said, you know, live your life in such a way that they will see Jesus and when necessary use words. Mm-hmm. You know, I think the idea is we've got to live our lives in such a way. It's both and, it's not either or.
That's right.
And I think what you just said Cameron, I think really is a great point. I think love solidifies our words.
Mm. Yeah.
Like love gives our words the power it needs. To, man, I think transform people's lives. And I hope that people are coming to Emmanuel, being a part of Emmanuel, you know, loving to be here. I think there's a spirit in Emmanuel that we preach truth, but we do it out of love. And I think our people know that, man, we love Jesus and we're not afraid to show that and to display that. And when this, and then what, when the scripture's tough, then we teach tough. And when the scripture is love, you know, we preach the scripture as what it says. We don't need to make it any more or less than what it is. Yeah. Right. But in the context of who we are, like we want the love of Christ to be reflected in our body.
Yeah.
That's what we want to be known by.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, I'll never forget that passage in, I think it's in Exodus where maybe Deuteronomy, but where Moses is getting ready to go into the promised land. And Jesus, you know, God comes to Moses and says, man, I can't go with you, but I'm going to send an angel in with you. Mm. And then Moses said, well, I'm going to stay in the desert. He said, because if you don't go with us, I love this. He says, how will they know what distinguishes us between everyone else? Mm. Like, I love that, man. He says, because basically he's saying, what is our distinguishing mark? Yeah. Like, if you don't go with us, we're just like everybody else.
Yep.
I'm going to stay here. I would rather be in the desert with you than in the promised land flowing with milk and honey. Because God promised it. He said, I'm going to send an angel in with you. Mm-hmm. You're good. Moses said, nope. Because what will distinguish us between the other people?
Yeah.
So that's a great question for us to ask. What distinguishes us between all the other people in Lebanon and Wilson County? Mm. That we go to church in Emmanuel?
Yeah.
You know, that we have three services and we love every generation. I mean, is that what distinguishes us? Yeah. Or is it how we love? Like, they look at us and go, man, they're different.
Yeah.
You know, and we want that for all churches. Like, we're not trying to compete with other churches in how we love. Like, we want all churches to be known for that. But as far as what we're responsible for, man, I want us to be known as people who love.
Yeah.
And are willing to speak truth and point people to the solution, and that's Christ.
Yeah, absolutely. That's good. Y'all have, we're over an hour now, so y'all have anything else to wrap
Yeah, did we up? Even get to the scripture? Yeah, anyway, so a lot, when you start talking about this, I think there's a lot yeah, to that can mean, be talked
we,
about.
We could probably go for another hour.
Absolutely. Well, you may not be able to, but you're...
I don't know, I'm pretty good now.
Well, I was
gonna
say,
a little bit sore, like the numbness is wearing off, so it's, I just got that sore now.
Feeling the pain.
That's amazing. Yeah. You don't have the Johnny Cash lip right now.
No, so yeah.
I think we're on
it earlier.
The right track.
Yeah,
did indeed.
I had other words for it, but anyway. Elvis, yeah, the Elvis lip a little bit. Yeah. Nice.
As you were speaking yesterday, just to kind of finalize my thoughts, I immediately was just visualizing Jesus with the children. I think that's a great gauge of genuine kindness.
Yeah.
Because kids can sniff it out.
Yeah.
And they flock to the people who they know.
Yes.
Genuinely love them and are genuinely kind. And that's what we want.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And just know this. For all those that are listening, love does, I don't say it comes with maturity, but it definitely grows with maturity. Mm-hmm. I definitely understand, there's a level of love I understand at 60 that I didn't understand at 30. And so I don't know if it deepens. I don't know if it, like, I don't know, you know, we could go into all that happens to get there, but man, when you're in your 20s and you're in the grind, you love your kids, you love your family, but trust me, you're going to look at it differently at 40 and you're going to look at it differently at 60, you know? And I wish you could look at it at your age, like I look at it at my age, but for some reason, that's just not the way God wires it, you know, God intends it. There's a part of that grind I think we go through and that's all in his plan and purpose. But it really does. Like, it's such a cliche, but it just gets sweeter, man. It really does. When you're pursuing Christ, you're pursuing your love for your kids, your love for your spouse, your love for your grandkids. Like, it just gets so deeper, you know, it gets so deep that you almost feel guilty.
Yeah.
They're like, man, surely I love my kids like I love my grandkids. You know, like you kind of have that thought in your head, you know, like I wish I would have loved Julie, you know, 30 years ago, like I do now, you know what I mean? Like you feel like, but it's a growing process. And I think we need to understand that you're not going to get it all at 20 or 25 or 30, but it's a part of that development in us. God always lets us, I'm going to tell you a quick story and I know we're over time, but this is really neat. I got home yesterday and got a call. Somebody called Madison, one of her friends from a church we were at years ago when I was in my 30s, that I really didn't feel like I did a very good job at. And we probably have had less contact with those people than any other people in our ministry, you know, and I've always felt bad about that because I just, anyway. And so, but what's interesting is that there's a lot of similarities between that church and this church. And so what I learned at that church has really helped me at this church. Which is kind of interesting. Well, a friend of ours called, and her dad died. Her dad was an amazing guy. His name was Clark Sauls. Amazing guy. And he was such a Southern gentleman. This was in Middle Georgia. And Julie and I have always laughed about his answering machine would always, he'd say, "This is Clark Sauls. Leave your name and number." You know, that's the way he talked, you know, and he was just such a, but the dude loved the Lord and he loved Sunday school. He was my outreach director back when we had outreach directors, and he led Tuesday night visitation and just a gentle spirited guy who would step in and speak gentle truth to me when I needed it as a young pastor who was just all over the place. So he passed. And so his daughter called and said, "Hey, listen, man, we would have loved to have you come down, but would you just send an email about your relationship with my dad and so they could read it at the funeral." I was like, "Man, absolutely." And I just said, Melinda, I said, "Listen, man, thank you so much for reaching out." Because like I say, we just not had much contact with folks from there, you know, and that doesn't mean anything. It's just, we've not done a good job of keeping up with folks there. And she kind of stopped and said, "Hey, listen, I need to tell you something. Like, you need to understand what your ministry here did for my husband." And I said, "Okay," because we were friends, but I never, he said, and she told me a couple things. She goes, he's never been the same in a good way since you left. He said, "Your ministry impacted my husband in a way that has lasted. And I just want to thank you for that." And I was like, "Wow, man, that's awesome. You know, thank you." And so anyway, I sent the email this morning and it was just really sweet to be able to tell that church, you know, thank you for loving us.
Yeah.
Because I feel like I learned more from them than I gave them, you know, but sometimes that's in God's economy of how he wants things to happen.
Yeah.
But it was sweet to hear her say, "Hey, let me tell you something that did happen when you were here," you know? So it's like God always drops these little droplets of love in our lives that just kind of affirms and lets us know,
right?
Hey man, it wasn't about you. Like, that's my church.
Yeah.
It's not yours. Trust me, you're good. I used you for what I needed you for, and you accomplished what I needed you to. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it was a great number one reminder for me to rethink about. Like, I'm so thankful for men like Clark Sauls, Al Bridges, Charlie Mayhew. Like, these are men in that church that were willing to love me in a way that was hard sometimes.
Yeah.
Because you can imagine me, dude, in my 30s. Like, I was, you know, all over the map in a very traditional First Baptist church in a county seat town in Middle Georgia.
Yeah.
You know, so I could tell you some stories. But but anyway, just for God to kind of remind me, like, I love you, and I'm going to drop something in your life just to help you with something that I've thought about for years.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That's the God that we serve.
That's cool.
I love that.
Yeah. So let your love back up your words, and also don't forget about the words. Like we said, they go hand in
hand.
That's right. We share the gospel, we share truth, but we love people in the process, and we let that love solidify what we're telling them. Because if we're followers of Jesus, we're called to live like Jesus lived, we are crucified with Christ. It's no longer us who live, but it's him who lives in us. So if we are following him and following his footsteps, we should be loving like he loved. So let's go do it.
Yep. And welcome home to our BCM Costa Rica mission team. They got home early this morning.
Yep.
Spent the night in the airport, but back in Nashville.
Got a little delay, but they're back. Yep. Welcome back. Can't wait to hear stories of that trip. But.
All right, wait a minute.
Uh-oh.
I can't find it now. I was going to end our podcast with my song.
With your song? You want me to do it? I'm connected to the...
Oh, are you connected? Okay. Yeah. See if you can find it, dude. I thought you were going to... Like when a minute ago when you said, I thought you were going to sing the song, Let Your Love Flow Like a... You may not know that song. You got it?
Yeah.
Fired up, bro.
All right, so to end it with the way that Jeff wanted to start it, we'll end with
because he Jeff's didn't like song. My song.
If this one gets flagged, it's Jeff's fault, not mine.
Is it gonna get flagged?
I don't know, maybe. TBD.
To think I could have been in this group.
Let's hear it.
You had to think about that.
What's wrong with the world, mama? People act like he ain't got no mama.
See? I got it, dude. Will I am got nothing on me, bro.
We should have started the service Sunday with that.
USA.
All right.
Bloods and the Crips. And all right.
Love people. We love you. Jesus loves you. Bye.